close your laptops or put away your phones. Then go ahead and stand. Again, maybe Dr. Parker, if you could just ensure, maybe you could just stay seated.
I will.
That would be great.
I will. I'm trying to stay out of the way today.
Wonderful. Everyone else can stand up, find a nice comfortable space to be.
Thank you.
So this time through, I want you to make sure you can change to the little fa mi at exactly the right time. If you were playing a drum or a tambourine, I still want to hear it. I still want to hear the bass part as well. Here we go. 1, 2, 3, and. Two things that we started with. Yell that. Hand drum and
tambourine.
Excellent. Dota, we put a big old X in hand drum and tambourine for the introduction. The verse also included la do do. I'm thinking that la do do, that first part, ba ba, sounds really nice on the metallophones. If you were playing, actually no, let's get some other people up here. So if you haven't played metallophone, come, I need three people to have a seat. Dotan, I want you to also add an X for bass xylophone and metallophone. So our bass part was do, 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 fa, 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 excellent. For verse part one, yes, thank you so much for making sure that we have big X's. They're much more visible. For the verse, the first part of the verse, we had do, 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 mi, do, la, 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 do. Was there anything in here, in this first part, that didn't it was exactly the same. So put X is, verse one, put X for hand drum, tambourine, and bass xylophone. And instead of metallophones, I think we made alto xylophones. So that was the part that you guys just learned right there. While the time is throwing those in all the way down, no metallophones in the second part, I want you to listen to the first part of the song. So let's make sure we don't have the drums there. Did we still have a tambourine? Yes, there was still a little bit of tambourine, so don't give us an X there. Did we have a bass xylophone? There's no bass xylophone actually in the song. Did we have a bass part? Kinda. It actually switches to like sort of a guitar part. So I think for our arrangement, let's just leave that one out. Metallophones I think should also stay out. And let's leave the ba 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 ba. That's soprano alto xylophone. Awesome. We're going to go from the top of the song and just see what this sounds like. So you get to go on the, you get to go on the bass xylophone part? Okay. All right, let's go from the top. If you are not playing an instrument, I want you singing the solfège of the melody or the bass line. Here we go. Just kidding. I want to hear that drum part. One, two, and drums and tambourine. Thank you. probably made that drum part on what? Or how do you think the producers or the composers of this song created that drum part? Yeah, so.
On a drum pad?
On a drum pad, perhaps. Are you thinking like practice drum?
Digital?
Yeah, exactly. Probably not something where they're recording the actual drum part directly into the computer, whatever the song is. Instead, we use what's called a drum machine. So I want to quickly go through how potentially they made this track. I'm going to do this together as a group. This is an app called Drumbit that I use a number of times with my middle school students. It's very intuitive, and so I'm actually not going to give very many directions about how to use this. Instead, we're going to, as a class, work our way through creating this drum beat. I think the important things you need to know that this is the play sign, and let's just see what happens. All right, for each person who gets the mouse, I want you to add one new thing to our drum part and then pass it on to the next person. Where can I start with my mouse? Who wants to add one new thing to my drum part? Anyone? Yes, thank you, Jason. Add one new thing to my drum part. Is that mouse working there?
Yeah.
Awesome. Can I make this any bigger?
Close.
Is it working? Yeah, there you go. All right, pass it on quick. Veronica, I have one new thing.
That's a little small.
Maybe not so intuitive, right? Like it doesn't necessarily, I don't know. It doesn't feel like super musical to me. That's okay though, that's okay. Let's keep this moving. I actually have, let's switch over here. Let's try, this time I want us either to remove it, or one of the, what happened here? I also want us to potentially try a different drum kit. So I'm gonna switch to the drum kit. Let's go to six. Okay, so now I want you to either add something or subtract something or change the drum part. See if we can get this into something that we put on the radio. Let's get two more.
What do people want? Oh my god.
Alright, pass along to Jenny. You get to choose a new drum set. So thinking about these two different interactions, these are both similar things to interactions I've done with students in the past. And I want you to think for just about 30 seconds, sort of formulate some thoughts. What was it like as a music learner in each of these interactions? The first one where we're learning the song with Ableton and putting it down here, and then the second one where we're working with the drum machine. What did it feel like as a music learner? And then what skills did I need to have before I taught? 30 seconds, think about that. We're going to do a cocktail conversation after this, so I want you to then find someone you haven't talked to very much this week. So take 30 seconds, think, and quick cocktail conversation. What was it like as a music learner? And then what skills did I need to be able to pull off these interactions? All right, I want you to stand up. We'll take 1 minute, find someone who you have not spoken with very much this semester. Share your two answers and go! Stand up. Find someone to talk to. Right, yeah. Okay. Yeah, so I had to have a knowledge of how to work the technology that I was using that I can show you in a second. I also had to have like a sense of like how the song actually went. I had to know the solfege, even though I was doing some wrong hand signs a few times. But I had to have some sort of content knowledge or musical knowledge about the song itself. Excellent. What else? Yeah.
The first part.
Each of us would have had the opportunity to work on it separately. Why do you think I would have started with everyone doing it together? Despite the fact that, like, yes, maybe I'm putting some people a little bit out in the open, Michael?
Because it gives everybody a chance to join in, so you build
everyone's confidence, so that when the second activity comes around, if somebody's not as comfortable, maybe they'll still give it a shot.
Yeah, exactly. It gave everyone the opportunity to sort of explore, to watch someone else use the program. You guys were pretty engaged during this one. I was actually a little bit worried passing around, like, would people space out or not pay attention? But you did exactly what fifth graders did. And you were, like, yelling out suggestions and, you know, making a lot of comments, which was fantastic. I really appreciate that. All right, thinking about the idea of teaching technology or teaching with technology, the first interaction we did, and this is just a screenshot from Ableton, the program I was using to break up the song Sunflower. That's more of an example of teaching with technology. I wasn't asking you guys to participate in any technology, use the program itself. I was basically doing, I guess it was a sort of phrase coupling model, but sort of extended out in a different way. But I was using this technology to teach. The second one, I'm teaching you how to use this technology. Now, thinking back to both the reading you did for today's class, or maybe it was the last class, and some of the things we have done this semester, I threw up a few of the pieces of technology we've used this semester. How did each of these sort of fit into either the teaching technology part or the teaching with technology? So how would you use one of these programs to either teach music itself or teach students about using that technology? I also want to hear examples that you guys have experienced yourself in your own musical learning, so other things you maybe have used in school, such as smart music.
Jason, so when I was in high school, we used Farmington to do like assignments, because it's like basically a recording device that records, like, you play the background track to the music you're about to play, and you play your solo part along with it, and it grades you on intonation if you follow the right rhythm, and it gives you like, oh, you messed up here, and these notes are wrong, and everything like that, and I think overall it helped me improve just being outside of the classroom.
What about some of the current GarageBand, NoteFlight, what was the other one, iMovie, it's not up there. Is that more of an example of teaching technology, teaching with technology? Yeah.
I feel like it could be both, but I feel like myself personally, the way I used it in high school would be like teaching technology. So like my high school did have a whole like room of computers that had Finale, but obviously I wasn't really able to afford Finale myself until like I was much older. So to be able to learn how to use like a platform like that I could then use for like multiple different classes, like for music theory or like just other different music classes I was in, like learning how to use that to then write like any arrangement that I would want for a group of my friends to play. I was able to use that, and then like once I became older and just like and started to learn how to use Finale, I could translate some of those skills on how to use like different notation software technology wise.
Yeah, absolutely. I think Finale or NoteFlight or whatever notation software you prefer is a really good example of both of these. The way we've used it this semester, you guys were asked to notate your tunes. So if you can imagine yourself being a teacher and creating these notations that you would then hand to students, that is a good example of teaching with technology. So you're using this technology to create a product that our students then can use. The other option, of course, would be then to teach your students to use NoteFlight itself, which would be some with maybe some composition or arranging or just basic notation assignment. And so it really depends on our objective, right? So we could have the objective of creating, giving our students notation, or we could have this objective of getting them to use the notation themselves. Other programs maybe that either you've encountered in the reading or have used yourself in your music.
just curious. Yes, James.
So like similar program to GarageBand, my high school has thing. And I took like a music tech course where we were just told to like, he taught us how to do simple things first and then we would make like a cool little tune or something and then we would build upon that. So I think it could be used for both as a student to create their own music and as like a teacher to teach it.
Yeah, absolutely. So that category of programs is usually referred to as DAWs or digital audio workstations, similar to GarageBand or Ableton, what I'm using, or there's like a million. I use Soundation with my students because that's a free one online. Lots of examples of that. All right, I want to quickly show one thing and then we have one final activity. So as a number of people have mentioned, in order to be successful teaching with technology or teaching technology, you have to sort of have a variety of different skills. We need to have skills about the content itself. So when we were doing our first interaction, I had some amount of knowledge about music itself, about the tonal syllables, and how it all fit together. I had some amount of knowledge about the program that I was using on my computer, and then I had some amount of knowledge about how I could get you guys to participate and be a part of this experience. This is a model sort of suggested by Bill Bowers, who is a well-known music educator and has written a lot about this. And right in this middle spot is sort of where all these come together and we actually have this interaction together. Now, your job is going to be to, in our last 11 minutes, use a piece of technology and decide what you think it would be best to use for, if it would be a piece of technology you could use to teach with or teach for your students, and then think of one application that you could use that for. So, this is where you need your devices. Everyone can pull out your phone, or if you have a laptop, that's probably easier. And just Google Chrome Music Lab once you have that up. We'll be working in partners, and for the last 10 minutes, I want you just to experiment with one of these and come up with an example of how you might use it in your classroom. I think there are 13 of these, so there's more than enough for pairs. Let's just do two, so whoever you're sitting next to is the person I want you to work with. We'll do 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, one is doing a slightly different one. So AJ, your group can do song makers. She's in your group can do rhythm. Claire, you can do the spectrogram. Maria and Dotan, I want you to do chords. This one here. Back here, Sam and Veronica, I want you to do sound waves. Jason and Tori, I want you to play with arpeggios. This one is really strange. And Vinsky, that would be Zoe and Jenna. And then Marissa, I want you to do Melody Maker. And then Michael and Dean, I want you to try the voice spinner. And Sweetie and Yvonne, I want you to check out harmonics. So where did my part one go? Take a few minutes to play around with your app, figure out what it does, and then I want you to talk to your partner. How would you teach this technology, or how would you teach with this technology, and think of one example you might use for this. Is anyone having any issues getting into the Music Lab, Chrome Music Lab? Michael, this will work on your phone if you want to try it on your phone.
Yeah, maybe just close out.
But if it does present some kind of like visual representation of sound, you can see what actually seeing the harmonic. I've been seeing maybe like someone getting really into their like tone, or just playing with it, making cool looking things. So to bring your thoughts together, let's have a few people share out of ideas how you might use this technology or revelations you had while playing with.
Let's have a group share out. Someone who thought they found something really interesting or really fun they want to share with the group, or a great idea, or like the spectrogram, like I don't know how I would ever use this in my class. Yes, babe, which one reminds us, which one did you use?
So we have the rhythm one.
This guy here?
Yeah, and it was very, very similar to the drum beat activity I think that you had us do in class, and I think the best way to do it would, you know, to kind of leave like the number part of rhythm aside and just kind of let kids experiment. But the cute thing about this is if you press the arrow, there are different kinds of instruments. So I think
this arrow.
Yeah, that
sorry.
I think it would be a good lesson in teaching kids, like, what is this? You
okay.
know, and it's easy for them to kind of, maybe they'll always associate, you know, the cowbell with the parrot, and that's fine, because they'll remember it in a different way.
Yeah,
so.
Absolutely. Yeah, I like all of those ideas. It's a very visual representation. Almost all of these examples are very visually based. Who else? What other ideas are called? Yes, Carol. Which one did you get?
We did Melody Maker, and it's really cool because you can write, I think only really in, like, maybe teach a tune or something, or have kids experiment with that if they're not comfortable or they haven't learned like music on the staff yet, but it's still like a visual aid to like show the contour or how music works.
Yeah.
You can also like maybe teach a canon if you like hit the button next to the play button, it like kind of echoes the pitches back, which is really cool.
Oh, oh yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. I don't actually know if, Dr. Parker, do you know all the, these are the Boomwhacker colors?
Mm-hmm.
These match? So I think Boomwhackers are the same color, so if you were to do the Boomwhacker activity, you could align those domes always red and red is orange, I think, and you is yellow.
Mm-hmm.
What else? Then we gotta go, but last thoughts. All right, well, thanks. Oh, yeah, Michael, go ahead.
So we got the voice thinner. So the voice thinner is pretty interesting because you press record and you can capture all the sounds that are going on in the room and you can speed that up or slow it down and it turns it into sometimes something funny.
Yeah, absolutely. This isn't going to work because the microphone's not turned on, but it's almost like a loop machine where you create the circular loop and then you can play it backward in different speeds. Thank you for all for your participation and your hard work today. We'll see you on Wednesday.
We're at Culminating Studios. You can do it.
Using xylophones.
No, who's using what? We have, I don't think they're going to be.